Live from Augustana College, this is WOG FM Radioactive here on the Unashamed Hour. I'm your host, DJ JD, and today is the big day. We've got the Tony Tillman interview. We're going to be playing it for you. I talked to Tony last night. He's a great guy. I had a really great time sitting down and talking with him. It was nice to get some more context about his album Camden, which I'll suggest you guys go out by and listen to because it is a fantastic piece of work. I'll be playing some songs from the album throughout the interview to give you guys some context on what we were talking about. If we talk about a certain song, I'll be playing it just so you guys get a full understanding of what the conversation was about. So we're going to get started here right off the bat with the interview here on WOG FM Radioactive.
So a few months ago, you released Camden. What really inspired you to make an album entirely based around the city you grew up in?
Man, a few things factored in that, man. One, a lot of stuff that's going on in society now, I feel like people don't have a commentary for it. You know, people don't really like understand or get that some people, why people feel hopeless or helpless. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. You know, I feel like that is kind of hard for some people because I feel like, I mean, not everyone who listens to your music is going to be from that situation. So I think sometimes it is hard to kind of get that perspective on it. So, right. Yeah, I definitely can understand why you'd want to kind of get that out and help people understand where you're coming from when you write your music and who you are as a person.
Yeah, yeah. And then, too, you know, I felt like God was, pushing me to a place to tell my story, you know, for his own glory. You know what I'm saying? I feel like I have a rich history as far as where I come from. God has brought me from a lot and brought me through a lot. So I think telling that story, you know, definitely gives some glory to him for where my life is today. You know, do that musically and then give the people from my town, from Camden, something to, you know, feel good about, feel excited about. And then look and say, you know what, if God can do that for him, which I know that guy, you know, if God did that for him, then do that for me. You know what I mean?
So how do you think that it has, is it different from your other projects that you've put out from, you know, Mic Check and the EP you put out a couple years ago?
Yeah.
I mean, you've definitely talked about your past before, but I think in this one you definitely dug deep and went really into, I know you've heard me talk about it, but like this is actually what happened.
Yeah, I want to be transparent as possible on this album, you know what I mean? I want to kind of give some detail on the background. So I like you said, I've given some background before, but it's been just kind of vague stuff, and I kind of alluded to some things and kind of left it for the imagination for people to just kind of figure or to assume, you know, where I come from. So this time, beats where God has brought me from. So, yeah, I want it to be, you know, transparent, but at the same time, relational. You know what I'm saying?
Definitely. So the first song off of the album, 870, I feel like a lot of times in Christian hip-hop albums today, they kind of have that instrumental that kind of slowly builds up at the very beginning. And I feel like with this, you kind of set the tone early, like, no, this is going to be real. This might not all be pretty. This, get ready for what's about to happen. Did you do that intentionally, try and start it off more with a bang?
Yeah, most definitely. Like, we sat in the studio, me and Derek Minor, we sat in the studio and actually talked about that, the way we wanted to the listener to unpackage the album, you know what I'm saying, listening to it. So we wanted to come straight out the gate with something that was, that defined the whole album. You know what I'm saying? We didn't want something that felt, that was misleading. So we didn't want people to hear it and then it'd be something that was a lot more gentle and then get into the album. And then the album is, cause the album is pretty heavy. You know what I'm saying? So I wanted to like set the tone early.
All right. And we heard Tony there talking about his intro to the song 870, we're going to go ahead and play it for you here on WOG FM Radioactive.
I I've always felt like my life was a maze, full of dark nights and delays. Somebody hit the lights, now let me display my life from the stage. Boy, this is life from a grave, raised up from trifling ways. From a town when beef is high, don't speak, cause them rifles a wave. Most of my partners don't rap, they clap, it's been nice in the cage. Where I'm from, youngers don't scrap, they strapped and they life with a spray. Word of OGs is like the Bible, idols rolling in regals. I know at least 12 disciples on site who never met Jesus. Plus the Crips on the power trip, fighting over who block is this. Mama's on their knees praying, asking God if he's watching this. It's coming to be fatherless, heroes far from Metropolis. They got two middle figures up, thugging like Tupacalypse. I grew up, endless like a new stem. Run up on that new truck, get you for that new M. Come up off them 18s, run them jumps like boot camp is drama. My stomach's rumbling, mama ain't got her food stamps. I wasn't raised on Caillou, just neighborhood, Crip and Piru. Whole family from the hood violate they laws and they'll try you. Youngin' told me Christians don't know dysfunction. Well, I do. My daddy's alcoholic, my older sister get high too. Cause like it get depressing, it'll drive you crazy. Homies drop out of school, get GEDs and join the Navy. Or they get locked up when they 20, hit parole in 80. Or they get zipped up while they mama scream, they kill my baby. This is for every kid from my city to yours who live in the duplex. And hand-me-downs admiring trappers wrapped in a new Lex. I'm trying to be your light through this darkness, I've been where you at. That's why I keep my ear to the street, it's like I've been suplexed. Ain't caught up in no rap politics, I'd rather let you flex. Here Camden in my speech, I can give two bleeps about who next. Or who best in your top five. I'm Tony, you say who that? It's Crip from Camden, hoping you hear what I say and shoot less. This testimony serves my treasure from deep within. Pour my soul out through this pen, hope to reach you wherever you at. So here's my story, how God delivered me from that blue set. I'm broken like the rest, God is beauty, I'm just a cute mess. Camden.
That was the title track, or the intro track, excuse me, off of Camden 870. We're going to get right back into the interview here on WOG FM Radio Active.
Definitely noticed that, because that is kind of what people are doing. They kind of slowly fade into it, but you were just like right out of the gates.
Yeah.
This is my life, and it's not a slow, graceful rise.
Right, right. Straight out the gate, wanted to come out swinging, man.
Yeah. And while you were in this writing process, was it kind of easier for you to write it, considering it was based more off of personal experience than previous songs, or having to dig deep and write about it, did it make a little bit more difficult?
I think artistically it was a lot easier, you know, emotionally harder. And I think it was harder emotionally because I had to live in a certain space. You know what I'm saying? You have to excuse me, man. I'm trying to plug my situation up, man. Make sure my battery don't run down. But it was a lot as far as writing. The writing was super easy because I didn't have to reach for content. You know what I'm saying? I just pulled it from a real place. I pulled everything, came from a real place, an authentic place. So it's like it's easier to just be authentic. You know what I'm saying? The content, the subject matter, everything was stuff that I personally experienced. You know what I'm saying? Versus trying to be creative and creating a sound and story based on things that other people go through. You know?
And then in the title track, Camden, you have a hook before the chorus that says, "Everybody got a Camden."
Yeah.
With that, are you referring to Camden as like the city, like everyone has a place that they grew up from that influenced them? Or is it more metaphorical? Like everyone has something that changed who they are and made them who they are, the person today.
Yeah, it's definitely metaphorical. You know, it's like everybody has a place where they started. It doesn't matter, you know, or everybody has that place, whether it's mental, physical, you know, whether it's a city, a town. You know, it's like everybody has a story, based on what I was saying, you know, because Camden is my story, you know. So metaphorically, everybody has a story. You may not be from a place like Camden where people are shooting, game banging, drug dealing, things like that. You may be from the suburbs, but you have a story. You know, you have a place where God is bringing you from and has brought you from. You know what I'm saying?
And now we're going to play that song that we were talking about, the title track Camden. It was featuring Daraj, Tragic Hero, and Drew Allen. So here it is on WOG FM Radioactive.
Follow me if you wanna, down memory lane. Everybody got trauma, everybody got pain.
Everybody got something,
something that they afraid. Say all out in the public, that's what it mean. Maybe it's all vain, all main. I remember that pain, I remember that thing. Won't give it no name, I won't give it no name. Unless it's gonna bring change, so somebody can change. Cause everybody insane, everybody insane. When you're going down the lane, going down the F, or going down your pass. Everybody got a Camden.
Being chased by a cop, and even with a closed door, that bass gonna knock. It be drowning out the noise of somebody getting shot down Broadway. A hooker right on every block. I remember when I heard it back in private school. All them little comments had a few. The teacher treated me like I was gonna be a criminal. Almost like they had a prearranged funeral. Like, where you from?
Camden.
I hated everything about it, but everything happens for a reason. And I be proving them wrong till the day that I'm gone. I was made in God's image, so I had it all along. I'm from Camden.
Older brothers a goner. Lost misguided youth, corrupted by drug abuse. Daddy be on that juice till he drink himself in a coma. But what do you expect when your city full of threats? And the only thing they offer you is death. Neighbors coming for your head, devils breathing down your neck. When your table lacking bread, it's whatever for them checks. In the ghetto they saying life is a dice roll, a game of averages. Ain't nothing good in a city full of savages. That's not true, the Messiah come from Nazareth. Even Jesus grew up in the hood. Everybody got a Camden.
This is my story.
Live from Augustana College, this is WOG FM Radioactive. You just heard the song Camden featuring Daraj, Tragic Hero, and Drew Allen off of Tony Tillman's Camden album. Right now, if you're just tuning in, we are listening to the interview I had with Tony last night. So we're going to get back into it here on WOG FM Radioactive.
Yeah, and just to kind of go off of, you know, bringing up from where you're from, what's kind of the story of how you found Jesus in your relationship with God? Like almost like a brief testimony, I guess, kind of.
Oh, my gosh. get the album. No. I got arrested for attempted murder. Was in jail. I left jail. And during this time, God was really dealing with me in these weird ways. Like, I was having dreams of, like, the end of the world, getting shot and dying. You know, I had friends who had died and been killed, and I was having dreams, these weird dreams about them. You know what I'm saying? Stuff like people coming from heaven and telling me, let's go up, and then we go up, and then telling me that I wasn't welcome. You know what I mean? It was some weird stuff. So on my way from jail to the courthouse, the police officer was playing a sermon from the book of Revelation, and I was just curious about it, you know, the narrative of it, and asked him about it. So he told me what it was. So while I was out on house arrest, I would read the book of Revelation like every single night, like the entire book of Revelation. And I didn't understand it. I just liked it for the narrative. And I just figured, man, this is how the world is going to end. You know, literally, you know what I'm saying? So around this time, every time I would get to, you know, about the part about the lake of fire, you know, I realized, like, this is me. I'm one of these people. You know, I became depressed about it and was just wondering, you know, like, man, how do I escape it? I just felt like that was my fate. And I had heard of Jesus, but I thought Jesus was for Christians. You know what I'm saying? I thought that's who Jesus was for. You're born Christian, or your family is Christian, or you're good enough to be Christian. You know what I'm saying? So I just figured I'm just doomed. So a couple years later, I ended up going to a church. I went like 3 times, and the third time I went, the pastor had preached this sermon from Matthew 24. Because around this time, I'm like trying to like clean my life up and saying, okay, maybe I can get my good to outweigh my bad. You know what I'm saying? And so church was one of the things on the list to do. So, but when I went, he did a cross reference with Revelation and kind of dove into some of that. And then he did a gospel presentation on how to escape the lake of fire. And it was like the light, like a light switch, like, oh wow. Like, I've heard of Jesus all my life. I didn't know Jesus was for me. You know what I mean? Cause I think if I recall right, he quoted something saying to the effect that Jesus didn't come, you know, with Jesus didn't come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. You know what I mean? So that was me. You know, I was like, I'm a sinner. Like, wow, Jesus is for me. He's not for the good guys, if you will. You know?
And so before all that happened, I mean, obviously before that, you wouldn't have wanted to be a Christian rapper. So, I mean, before all that, what was your plan? What were you... Did you want to still be a rapper? Was that kind of always something you wanted to do? And then when you got saved, it just kind of happened? Or was rapping kind of out of the picture until?
Nah. I rapped, but I was more of a freestyler. You know, I freestyle, you know, at school, in my neighborhood, you know, things like that. But I wasn't a songwriter. I didn't write songs and, you know, pursue rapping. I just figured, you know, to be honest, before I was a Christian, I thought I'd be dead by the time I was 19, you know what I mean? 18, 19 years old, I figured I'd be dead. So I lived real fast, did a lot of stupid stuff, thinking that that was my fate, you know what I'm saying? So when I became a Christian, you know, I had never heard of Christian rap. So I thought, the days of rapping were over for me. You know, I thought those days were gone. I didn't think Christian could rap. Like, Christian and rap don't even make sense. They didn't make sense to me, you know what I mean? And so when I started writing poetry, I would read the Bible a lot, and the stuff I learned, I wrote poems about them, you know, and then eventually they turned into melodies, and I would just, you know, just recite them, you know, in front of my family and stuff like that. And then I wrote my first Christian rap. I thought I discovered something, you know. It was like, man, just discover something new, you know. Yeah, you know, I thought I created a whole new genre. I was like, man, this could do a lot for people, man. It could do a lot for the world, you know. And then this guy named Jonathan Daniels, man, I never forget him. They called him Eyebrows. He was a Christian rapper, and I didn't know him. I met him for the first time probably a week after that, and then he just kind of opened up this world, and it was like, man, this is a whole culture. You know what I'm saying? I think the first one of the first artists that I had ever heard of was like Flame. Flame, Lil Rascal, you know, guys like that. So it was like, wow, this is a culture, you know.
And so you had briefly talked about that in your YouTube series on RMG's channel, the Camden series, with you going back and talking to everyone that you grew up with. Was that the first time you had been back, like, in a long time? Like, do you visit there frequently, or is that like a rare stop for you to go back to Camden?
Yeah, no, it was the first time I had been back in the open like that. You know, like, I go back holidays, you know, I visit, you know, family members. If I see somebody that I know walking, I'll stop and we'll talk. But it was my first time in some of those places. That was my first time being there. You know what I'm saying? Man, since I became a Christian. But yeah, I go back frequently.
All right, we just heard him talking about Camden, the city he grew up in. We're going to play a song now called About Me. We didn't really talk about it in the interview, but I think what he talks about in the song goes along with what he was just talking about from where he grew up. So we're going to give a listen to About Me by Tony Tillman here on WOG FM Radioactive.
What you know about Queen City? No crown unless royal follow. Arkansas is my birthplace where they look for hope inside a 40 bottle. No job, they work though. Move perfect in that new Impala. Them dolphins and these alcoholics, they'll do anything to snatch $40. Boy, that's the town that I come from. That's the place where I came up. Social life was like nightclubs. That pow, pow, if you flamed up. Bill Clinton don't live here, just dope fiends and abandoned children. No hoop dreams, just a couple shooters trying to hide a body in abandoned buildings, boy. It's too small to be New York, but the poverty and crime feel like I grew up in Detroit, yeah. Stood up on the block with a Roski struck, bust a couple shots with the Glocks before my roots go deep. What you really think you know about me, boy? What you know about me? About me? What you know about me? About me? What you know about me? About me? About me? About me? What you know about me? About me? What you know about me? About me? What you know about me? About me? About me? About me? What you know about? What you know about? Hate the way that your life feel. Your life feel. Your role model sell dope like it's they life skills. On Section 8 and y'all can't afford to buy a nice grill. Your single mama sent the food stamps to pay life bills. Boy, what you know about? Feeling hate for your pops. In the same town, see him ride around and he passed by and don't stop. Stop, stop. Getting tired of spams and you hiding yams in your socks. Butterflies in your gut, scared to get body slammed by them cops. Joy riding, I was sitting in the car. 15, I was getting in the bar. But deep inside, was a good kid in the mad city. I was Kendrick Lamar. Lost a product of my bad environment. Where being thug was a requirement. And the hate can seek is like retirement. And you take whatever you desire it. What you know about me? About me? What you know about me? About me? What you know about me? About me? About me? About me? What you know about me? About me? What you know about me? About me? What you know about me? About me? About me? About me? What you know about sitting down in your granny crib, then hearing shots? Them cops come, cover up the body in the parking lot.
In the parking lot.
You think about that image till your dome hurts. You can't even concentrate on homework. He act out, that's all you see. Don't know my PTSD. It's hard to be optimistic and hope when you know you might not see next week. Surrounded by blue rags and red tees. No Lexis, no ESV. Just VLs and GDs and project walls. You trapped in till a gunshot set you free. What you know of no father figure, just a few OGs. Single mama bringing home a man, neglecting you to ensure he don't leave. Dreaming of a good life we don't see. Homeboy get shot, we don't grieve. Rules of engagement is get revenge. And don't call no laws, don't trust police. And that's what they teach us from birth. Discount your life till you gone. They tell us we nothing but dirt, so we live in the dark with a heart made of stone. But what if I tell you they wrong? They been giving us laws all along. They been telling the death is the only way out. That's a lie, you can take it from tone. I know the truth, I am the proof. I seen the mountain, I've been to the top. I know the pain, I've been in games. I got a homeboy who been killed by the cops. I can show you the way if you willing to watch. If you willing to watch. I've been dealing with Jesus. I know the way that the feeling can stop.
So.
All right. And then speaking of RMG, what's it like being on such a diverse record label like it? They've got, I think you got 6 people now on it,
yeah.
All with different backgrounds and different styles of rapping. What's it like being a part of something like that? What's the atmosphere when you guys get together?
Oh, it's fun, man. It's fun. It's fun because everybody's different. You know, nobody's the same. You know, there's not a lot of clashing. Because our personalities, you know, really complement one another, you know, rather than our personalities clashing with each other. Musically, you know what I'm saying, it's challenging to this in the sense of we challenge one another. And it's like this friendly, it's an atmosphere of friendly competition. You know, I may write a verse, and I'll send it to Canon and talk bad about his verse and be like, "Ma, man, I killed you on your verse." Yeah, he'll, you know, it's like he lives for that. You know what I mean? He lives for the competition. Him, Derek Minor, Chad Jones. Let me see. It's us for B Coop, Daraj, you know, all those guys. You know what I'm saying? Like they live for that competition. But then it's also a thing where it's like you can send songs off to them and they give you their honest opinions. You know what I'm saying? If they don't like something, they're not afraid to say, "I don't like it." You know what I'm saying? So therefore, if they say something is good, then you can have the confidence that, you know, it's good. And they all have good taste when it comes to music, you know what I'm saying, art.
You know, because when I listen to different artists on RMG, I can definitely tell that they're all from the same label, but you can also tell that their personal touch is on a lot. There is a different sound from each artist that's coming off of their album.
Yeah.
And speaking of Derek Minor and Canon, you're currently touring with them on the Empire Tour right now, correct?
Yeah. I'm doing some touring with them, man. I have like a couple of more dates with them. And then I'll start touring with Fizzle.
Jason and Sean Johnson are on that as well, right? How has that been? What's it like being on the road with Derek Minor and Canon and touring the country?
You know what I'm saying? Like, we don't just make music together. You know what I'm saying? Like, we do life together. You know? Like, it's real, you know? Like, when Canon had his accident, we were there. Like, we were always there. You know what I'm saying? We was there for him, there for his family. You know what I'm saying? So, like, that's real. You know, so to be out on the road with them, it's like, it's not strange to be around them. You know what I'm saying? So, it just, now we just kind of let our hair down and get to kick it a lot more. Because we, you know, Canon lives in Atlanta. Me and Derek live in the Nashville area. You know, Coop, he lives in the Nashville area. Chad lives in Memphis. And Daraj lives in Orlando. You know what I'm saying? So, it's a thing where when we do get together, you know, it's always fun. So to actually be able to live with them on the road is even more fun, to be able to do something you love with the people you love. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, definitely. What's it like seeing Canon now back up on his feet doing what he loves? How that's got to feel so great to see him out there having fun again.
Yeah, nah, that's beautiful, man. It's beautiful. I mean, it's a testimony to God's greatness, God's goodness, mercy, his grace, you know, his love. Like, it's all those things to be able to see, you know, him back where, you know, that was a time where we were wondering, you know, we went from wondering if he would live to will he be able to even walk again? Will he be able to even talk again? You know what I mean? Same. So to see that and see him making a recovery and still recovering, you know what I'm saying? But his progress, I mean, he's a fighter, you know, he's a fighter, and God has been good to him. So that's good to see, man.
No, I remember even just from not knowing him personally, just listening to his music, when I saw him perform for the first time on stage again with KB, seeing that video. It's like, it just felt so good to see him up there again and having fun, because you can tell when listening to his music or seeing him just how much he loves doing it and the excitement in his face. So it's got to feel great to be on the road with him again.
I think that's the thing that really feels good about it, because, you know, like, I know how much he loves what he does. You know what I'm saying? I know how much he loves to be around the people, you know, to touch the people and talk to the people. You know what I'm saying? So to see him being able to still be out there doing that after what he's gone through, you know, is a blessing, man.
Definitely. What you and Canon have put out a lot of songs together over the past couple of years. Is there one that you, like, listen to and you're like, okay, that one was on another level. That's got to be my favorite collab with him.
Probably. That's two, and that's for different reasons. One is on his album, Different. To me, that was another level for me, because I freestyled that verse.
Really?
Yeah, I didn't write that verse.
That's because that for me is like probably one of my favorite verses you've ever. To find out it's a freestyle. That's great.
Yeah, that's what, like. Yeah, I listen to that and I always be like, wow, I can't believe I did that, you know, and like, it came out pretty good. It's a freestyled verse, you know what I'm saying? Unwritten, unscripted, just went into the studio and pushed record and just started spitting, you know what I'm saying? So, that was another level, man. It was like otherworldly stuff, man. So, that one, and then the one he just did on my album, man, is very special to me, because it's his first feature back, you know what I'm saying? When he came back, the first feature he did was on my album. You know what I'm saying? And he went nuts on it. You know, like, he snapped. And,
yeah.
So it's like that one is real special. You know what I'm saying? Because it was like when I got the verse back from him, And what's funny, like, we went through something before, like, he went through a confidence struggle, you know, where he struggled with his confidence because he didn't, hadn't rapped in a while, he didn't know how he would sound, you know, he didn't know what he would do in the long run. And so mentally, he was just kind of in that space where he was like, he don't know if, you know, he could do it anymore. You know what I'm saying? So to get the verse back, it was like a confirmation, like, yeah, Canon's back. You know what I'm saying? Canon's back.
All right, you just heard Tony Tillman talking about his song Without You, featuring Chad Jones, Canon, and JC, and we're going to listen to it right now here on WOG FM Radioactive.
They said I would make it. They said I would come to some numbers and papers. Just another one saving. Another one taking. Your love is amazing, but oh, where would I be? Where would I be if it wasn't for you? If it wasn't for you, where would I be without you? Sister act. That means she got habits, she snorting that girl. And she made whoopee brought me in this world. And she gave me away, I don't hate her no more. But don't love her the way that I coulda, shoulda, woulda been. Coulda grew up taking trips to parks in a Woody van. Or coulda lived as a kid selling math. Chefing on my own death, fall out, stealing suit of Fez Jones. That's my name now. Living for the guy who done came down. The blessed guy who done blessed my soul. Under stress I fold, I'm a mess, but his grace high. I celebrated where I be, I never make it. In my past, you done put me on the path. With a past now I wear it like it's laminated. Everybody see it, everybody fascinated. But all my life,
they said I would make it. They say I would come to some numbers and papers. Just another one saving. Another one taking. Your love is amazing. But oh, where would I be? Where would I be if it wasn't for you? If it wasn't for you, where would I be?
Still on the west side with a tech nine in my chest, I flex it. Correction, probably in corrections. Trying to think sharper than the shank for protection. Living dark and I ain't talking about complexion. Probably dead without a hope of resurrected. Resting with a couple partners I lost. Looking back, comparing that to where I'm at is such a blessing. On my Tupac, shouted, wanna be a thug. Till God saved me, yeah, he did it for the love. On the curb, working like a waiter trying to serve. Till grace hit me when it should have been a slug. Put it on the blood, and I ain't talking sumo. Dilemma, God possessing me, and I ain't talking voodoo. And everyone is begging me, be there by never, who knew? They say that everybody see the heaven till I knew you. All my life.
They said I would make it. They said I would make it. Just some numbers and paper. Just another one saving. They said, another one saving. They love is amazing, but oh, where would I be? Where would I be? Where would I be? If it wasn't for you.
Thrown out, 6 feet with the bones out. Dead or in jail, knocked out, drunk and stoned out. Forget party and I be in the back by the dark house. Influence off of that gin and juicing. I'm cooling them, used to win shooting parties. I'm loose enough of Bacardi. Hardy and Harley ever been golly. Nothing I wanna be knocked out. Pops could've walked out. Mother, she could've been single living in her house. But where would I be? Put them on Riddle and that would never me wild. Without the blood on the cross, could nothing settle me down and down. And I told you I should've never been crowned. The color king trying to cover, couldn't cover a town. I found it. Now I am a frame, we don't want the light. But without Christ, we'll miss eternal life. You gotta get through the sun and get to the Father. The world goes far, but Christ goes farther. I ain't gotta be scared cause I'm walking with armor. God is full of omnipotence, no need for a partner. Would've been dead, stuck in the 40 for dismissing. Found later, they wondering how to become a victim. Now I'm walking the wind, surgery shaking me thin. But no fear for nobody, gotta hell to heaven to put me in. I look back, thankful to God that I'm back. It ain't nothing stopping me now, but my train on the track. My heart is harder than ever, my life is nothing together. But where we get out, if it's worth it, to get it better. Me better or worse, I'm gifted here with a curse. God is the only reason I'm breathing and even it hurts. Thinking the Father, you the reason that everything works. Nothing can move without his approval, not even the church. Thinking the Father, you the reason that everything works. Nothing can move without his approval, not even the church.
right. You just heard Without You featuring Chad Jones, Canon, and JC by Tony Tillman off of his Camden album. We're going to get back into the interview here on WOG FM Radioactive.
You know, seeing his name on Camden is going to be good to finally...
Yeah.
And then a lyric that you have off of the intro song for Welcome to the Family, that album that you did with RMG a few years back, you talk about how people think that because you used to be in a gang that it's almost your duty to try and bring in people to listen to the music and to convert them. If they don't feel it, then, I mean, my music's not for them. You know, I can't really make them like my music if they're not feeling it. Do you still have that same stance? And do you kind of feel like, as Christian hip-hop artists, that you guys almost have an obligation to try and convert people? Do you feel like there's pressure from people for you guys to do that?
Yeah, I say no, I don't have that same stance. you grow, you learn, and that, you know, the space I was in then, you know what I'm saying? It was like certain teachings that I had got from other people that I admired and looked up to that I later learned, you know, was wrong teaching. You know what I mean? Like, I had been taught wrong in that mindset, you know, and in my convictions. That's why in my on Inspiration, the song Inspiration on Camden, I said, I can't run from my convictions. You know what I mean? And that's the thing, while, you know, I'm away thinking that, you know, I'm serving the body and serving the church musically and artistically, you know what I'm saying? When I go home for holidays or I go and I do community service here in my own community, you know, around people who still live in those conditions, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
As an artist, for me, as an artist, I don't feel like every artist is obligated for it because most artists don't come from that, you know what I'm saying? But I feel like for me as an artist personally, you know what I'm saying? I feel like it's my obligation to use my voice, you know, and use my gifts and my talents to bring attention and to bring some light and clarity on that lifestyle and those conditions. You know what I'm saying?
You know, and that's good to hear, because I feel like a lot of times people criticize Christian hip hop artists and they're like, oh, you guys are just selling out. You know, you're just trying to sell CDs. You know, what are you doing outside the booth? So it's good to know that, I mean, even after you're done recording, you're still out there spreading the word and giving back to the community and trying to actually make a difference in the world.
Yeah, but I think the thing that's funny, it's funny that you even say that, because people do say that, oh, they just want to sell albums. But, you know, the funny thing is you would sell more albums by being more preachy, because Christians buy Christian music. You know what I'm saying? Like, so, you know, if I'm trying to sell more albums, you know, I think I would try to create the sound that's more popular and that's readily acceptable, you know what I'm saying, and accessible. So I feel like an album like Camden, you know what I'm saying, I feel like there's no way, you know, that a person can listen to the album and say he just wants to sell albums. You know what I'm saying? I was nervous about Camden. I was nervous about the album because I felt like it wouldn't get a warm reception. You know, but I felt like it was an album that was needed. It was an album that God, I felt like it was an album that the Holy Spirit led me to create. You know what I'm saying?
And so with the whole Christian hip hop artist things, I know some rappers like that term. Some people don't. They don't want to be put in a Christian hip hop box. That's the genre that they're... Do you have any problem with Christian hip hop being the genre under you? Do you consider yourself a Christian hip hop artist, or do you think that you're something else?
Yeah, no, I don't have a problem with it at all, you know, simply because, I mean, it is a box. Hip-hop is a box. R&B is a box. Gospel is a box. Blues is a box. You know what I'm saying? Pop is a box. They're all boxes, you know. So when somebody says, you know, I don't want to be put in a Christian hip-hop box, well, the question is, okay, what box do you want to be put in? You know what I mean? So people desire to be put in a different box for their own, you know, personal reason whatsoever. I won't try to, you know, judge and say the reason. But for me, no, personally, I don't have a problem with it, only simply because I know I'm going to be put in that box, because what I talk about is Christian, is from a Christian worldview. You know what I'm saying? I don't talk about things from a non-Christian worldview. So I expect to be put in a Christian genre box, you know what I mean? So, and then I embrace it, you know? Like, I mean, I embrace it. I'm a Christian. I'm a Christian who raps. I'm a rapper who is a Christian. You know what I'm saying? So when a person say, oh, you're a Christian rapper, like, yeah, I am. Or if they say, oh, you're a rapper, Yeah, I am. Are you hip hop? Yeah, I am. Are you Christian hip hop? Yeah, I am. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's the thing. You know, it's like not everybody can say that they're Christian and hip hop at the same time, neither. You know what I'm saying? So, like, you wouldn't say 2 Chainz is Christian. You know what I'm saying? You wouldn't say his music is Christian. It's not spoken from a Christian worldview. Now, I'm not saying he's not a Christian, but his music isn't spoken from a Christian worldview. So I feel like as long as I speak from a Christian worldview, people are always going to categorize me as being Christian. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. And when you're writing your music, does that faith in Christianity, does it come out naturally? Is it just how you write your music, or do you have to put thought into it? Like, okay, how do I put this into a Christian perspective? Or are you already just locked in that mindset when you start writing?
Yeah, nah. I just write what I feel. I just think, you know what I'm saying? And that's how it is, you know. It's what the Bible teaches, you know, from the abundance of the heart, man speaks. You know what I'm saying? So that's what's in you will come out. You know what I'm saying? So for me, you know, what I write is what I think, you know, and I don't have to try to make something sound Christian. Now I'm mindful, don't get me wrong, I'm conscious of, you know, of what I'm saying, but to the extent that wondering, okay, how would people feel about this? You know, if I have a certain line or a certain song, okay, how are people gonna feel about this? How will people receive it? Like I said, the Camden album, I was concerned that the audience that give that ear to my music wouldn't understand what I was writing, wouldn't get it, you know what I'm saying, and would ultimately reject it and push it away, you know. But you know, it was a pleasant surprise to see them embrace it and really enjoy the album, man.
And just going off of that, the not knowing how the album people are going to react to it, do you think that your past, does that affect your listening group now? Maybe not the contact specifically, but who you are or who you were, I guess, before. And do you think that brings in a certain crowd? Being a former gang member, do you think that pushes away certain people or brings more people in? Do you think it has an effect on the audience?
I think from a natural standpoint, I think people who aren't Christian hear it and appreciate it just from the artistic value. I mean, I think they listen to it and be like, man, this is artistically good. And then when they sit with the content, I think it paints a picture for them that they're familiar with. You know what I'm saying? So I feel like it ultimately does draw them. It draws them in the perspective of them saying that, you know, I relate to what he's talking about. Or, you know, this is a guy who relates to me, you know. So, from a Christian standpoint, I think some Christians are pushed away by it because when they define Christian rap, they think it should be, you know, like super theological, super, you know what I mean? And some people are like that. Some cats are like that. Some rappers rap that way, but not all rappers rap that way. You know what I'm saying? And I think some Christians, it drew some Christians that initially didn't listen to my music, you know, or didn't enjoy some of the past records that I put out, you know, they really enjoyed this record. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I think on all fronts, you know, you're going to have those that you win over, those that you lose, and those that don't care. Either way, you know what I'm saying?
And so you gave, like, 2 Chainz as an example for someone who's not in Christian hip-hop. You know, for those kind of artists, they have, you know, pluses, I guess, to what they be considered, you know, like, parties and money and drugs and all that. What do you think are like what are the pluses for you being a Christian hip hop artist off the stage? What are some of the pluses that come along with being a Christian hip hop artist?
Yeah, for me, you know, continuing to be active in my community, you know, in my church, among people that I know, living, reflecting the life that I talk about. You know what I'm saying? The person, not so much as the life I talk about, but the person that people hear in the record, you know, like off the stage, I'm the same person. You know what I'm saying? Like, I think those are the things that I wear, you know, as a badge of honor, you know what I'm saying? Just being an authentic person, you know what I'm saying? When I go back to Camden, you know, like the person that people hear on the record, that's who people know. You know, so when I go back, people respect me. Like, I get a lot of respect from my own hometown, you know, my own family members and for friends that I used to have, like, they respect me a lot. So those are the things that I think, and they respect me not just because, but they respect me because they see me, you know, my life. They see what I do, and they see that I actually live and walk out, you know, what I talk about, not perfectly, you know what I'm saying? But for the most part, like, who I am is who I am, you know what I'm saying?
And then, just to kind of wrap it up here, what should people be looking for Tony Tillman in the future? I know you got the Empire Tour now, and then you'll be starting the tour with Thistle. Your album's not really all that old yet, so, I mean, is there anything in the near future other than those two tours that people should be looking out for from Tony?
Yeah, more music.
More music?
More music, man.
I like the sound of that.
More music, man. I think in the past, I was trying to figure out who I was as an artist, you know what I'm saying? Really unsure, but I think the Camden album, I think that album is the way it is because during that time of creating it, I discovered who I am as an artist, you know? So now pushing forward, you know, I don't think there will be the space and lapse time that it has been in the past and creating, you know, albums and projects, you know, because now I know which direction I should go in, you know what I mean?
And speaking of music, would you be able to spittle something for us right now?
Yeah, man. All right, here we go. I was high, rolling through my city, screaming ride or die. Urban youth full of hurt, had that work before a 9 to 5. Heart was dark as Nino Brown. Thank God that he killed a lamb. This is what you get when you mix up Tupac with Billy Graham. Used to be out on the block. People told me all the time they gon' see me in the box. Either Dustin one with some bars or a cedar with a top. Laid to rest, who would've guessed he'd be a leader of the flock. But I growed up, slowed down, let go of the signs that I throwed up. Had flags up, but I tore them down. Heard the voice of God, then I folded up. Now I'm out here like a front yard, going hard like a point guard. A lot of people thought that I'd be dead right now, but I really hate to disappoint y'all. Psych. No longer drifting like a car race. Good night to the bad guy. R.I.P. to Scarface. Hello. Good night to the black sheep. Hello to the black sheep. I should send my car with my regards to the heartaches. Ah, something like that. All right. Put me on the spot, man.
I don't like it. You know, awesome. Well, yeah, that's all I got for today. So thank you so much for joining us. And Tony, I really appreciate you being the first guest on the Unashamed Hour here on WOG FM Radioactive. Huge supporter of your music. Love the album. And I just hope you keep it up. I love what you're doing.
Appreciate it, man. Thank you.
All right, cool. Good luck on the rest of your tour. I know me personally, me and a couple friends are going to be driving up to Cincinnati to see you guys, so look forward to seeing you then, and I'm sure it'll be a great time. So have fun with that and any new music you got coming out. Thanks again for joining us.
Yeah, man. Thank you, man.
All right, I'll talk to you later, Tony.
Peace.
All right, so that was the interview with Tony Tillman. Again, I'm really grateful and thankful for the chance to sit down and talk to him like that. I've been a big fan of his work for many years now. I'm going to play a song now called Different. He talked about it earlier in the interview. This is off of Canon's debut album, Mad Haven. But this verse, he has the first verse, and this blew my mind because this is like one of my favorite verses that he's ever done. And he told us in the interview that this was a freestyle off the dome, just had nothing going in, heard the beat, and this is what came out. So we're going to listen to Different here on WOG FM Radioactive.
I'm different. I done dipped my brush in the bucket of God's glory, hoping to paint the world a new picture, a new story. When they've never seen with a clear mind, excess to put it into practice. I'm different. Yeah.
Trying to put me in your box won't do. I got too much in my system, so what you gon' do? You ain't only me who different. I done brought the whole crew from a planet where the same old tradition won't do.
Feel like I spit gold, you know what that mean? Got sick flows, you need vaccine. My whole clique cold, we need jackets. We don't fit modes, we don't match it. And I'm screwed up, can't chop me out. You an eclipse that can't block me out. Can't lock me in, it can't lock me out. Try to box me in, then I'm popping out. Wow. So run and tell the people I'm jet. If you want real, then I got that track. You a rap fiend, then I got that crack. If you want fire, then I got that mat. And you can't clone that or rehearse those. Got dope track that we murk those in the snapback in my church clothes. Rap kids with diverse roles. It's like first for no truth.
Imagine all that is to me. Oh my my, drop your box and trash that lock and key. Oh, why?
Different me, different me.
Best believe
tryna put me in a box won't do.
I'm a different me, different breed.
Best believe
tryna put me in a box won't do.
Yeah,
tryna put me in your box won't do. I got too much in my system, so what you gon' do?
Define me. I'm Johnny's depth, the intricate palette of my personality times three. Insanity flow, hit 'em hard with a jack. My ID is me, the creative mind with intelligence, knowing that God is inside me. And if this was a league, then I can't tell how many styles I have. It's ID. He designed me, unique in a wonderful matter of God's being. I'm just a small thing, I drop in the bucket, too tiny to find me. I may be small, but never will I see the wall of a box around me. Take us to the bank, and I bet for your last $2 that some have been thinking I will take. But God has built me, built with the power to last, no matter what haters may think. I'm a different breed of what they may call the intelligent. I'm nothing you may trace, uniquely designed to color the world with God's glory, no matter the case.
What you see isn't all there is to me. Oh my, drop your box and trash that lock and key. Oh my,
different me, different breed.
Best believe
tryna put me in a box won't do.
I'm a different me, different breed.
Best believe
tryna put me in a box won't do.
Different, I'm different, yeah. Got me saying, oh, 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 oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh.
So that was Different by Canon featuring Tony Tillman and TJ Pompeo. Again, that first verse was the only thing that Tony did on that track. He talked about it in the interview, totally freestyled off the top. That it blew my mind then, and it still blows my mind now, because that is probably one of my favorite verses, not just from him, but of any song I've ever heard. So another song we're going to do here, this one is by Tony Tillman. It's off of the Tillman EP that Tony released back in 2013. It's called Heaven featuring Out of the Dust. So here it is on WOG FM Radioactive.
This is one of them songs, yeah, one of them songs that make you lay in the bed, think about going home. I'm talking about the one that we don't see in the air. You know the one that Jesus promised he would go to prepare. You know the one that when you read it, your heart was sold on it. Gates made out of pearl, streets of gold on it. Yeah, man, my heart keep telling me hold on. Here come through on what he promised, I'm wondering how long. Cause waiting on my savior got all my emotions mixed up. Anxious every day, feel like I'm waiting on Christmas. They ask me why you in such a hurry to see the sun drop. You don't hear that ambulance, you don't hear that gun pop. You don't see that mother crying, scared cause her son shot. You don't see that line of cars sitting at his mom spot. Then go and get your eyes checked, cause I'm sure that your sight is obscured by objects. Woke up this morning to a horror story breaking on the news. Another dude with a gun shooting up a school, and man, it cut me deep. Both of my eyes leaked, hit my knees weeping, asking them when will the crime cease? When will people no longer be buying them nines cheap? Overdosing on pills and blowing that pine leaf. Cause you've been burying your friends that's barely reaching their prime. Then hit the bar on the bench and still don't find peace. Think of something so sweet, okay. A loving God, angels, pearly gates, and gold streets, okay. Probably not, cause the pain you feel is so deep. Just last week a kid took 5 to his old bleats. He deceased, and he wasn't murdered by an OG, but by the police. Yeah, you heard me right, the police. And he didn't even have a thing, but that ain't what they claim. Like, we can't even trust the police.
will change when we all get to heaven. He will dry your eyes, fear will subside. He will change everything when we all get to heaven.
And one day we ain't gonna be hurt. Nevermore, never hunger, never see thirst. No longer be cursed the moment that we leave earth. No longer fear, see tears drop on our t-shirts. On everything, drink freely, won't even need a price. Or need a gun for protection, and that'll be the life. The sun will be in the city, won't even need a light. And that's the best part about it, cause we gon' be with Christ. And all the people who die before they can see tonight, we'll reunite with him in the sky, and won't need a flight. If it's relations, so neither nation will need to fight. And no more famine, we all gon' eat from the tree of life. No more prisons, cause we gon' lead them right. No more mourning over them 211s. Our parents burying children before they 27. No more suffering, sin of Satan's deceiving might. We'll see a brand new life the day we get to heaven.
Love's so hard to find.
Yeah.
No hope in this life.
Only pain. But that'll change when we all get to heaven. Yeah.
He will dry your eyes.
Yes, sir.
And that is going to do it for us here on the Unashamed Hour today. I had a great time talking to Tony last night, and I really appreciate everything that RMG has been doing for the show. Next week, be sure to tune in. We got another interview. I'll be talking with indie artist No Big Deal. I'm really excited for that, so be sure you guys don't miss it. Thanks to everyone who listened in. Be sure to like the Facebook page and follow us on Twitter at the Unashamed Hour. We will be posting on those sites a YouTube video. I recorded the interview, so we'll be putting that up. So in case you missed some of it and want to rewatch, you can do it there on YouTube. So have a good day, everybody, and I'll see you next week here on WOG FM Radioactive.